actual relationship as opposed to seeing what can come of, what they can get from.
It's interesting because for years, and I've been in LA now for years, is people are like, oh, LA's not authentic. Everyone's a phony. Everyone's trying to get in your pocket. I don't know, and I'm not naive to human nature by any means. I mean, I was a cop. I mean, I'm very keen to what people, you know, I really believe I know people. I think there's good people everywhere. I don't think it's more maybe it's more transnational because there's a bigger population in New York and LA, but I think good people are everywhere. And I think there's authentic people that just want to have good relationships. That's just my opinion. I do kind of chuckle because I have friends of mine get frustrated. Oh, LA's a, I can't wait to move out of here. It's such a fake town. Is it? I don't know. I don't hang around fake people. It's who you gravitate to, right?
So, yeah, I mean, look, I mean, we're in a group of people that are incredibly sincere, and we both have built incredible relationships, including our own, from that group. So there's that intention, right? And it can come from the within, I think, right? The idea that it's who we are that we can attract.
That's it. That's the key. Yeah, for sure. And it goes back to who you spend the most time with, and, you know. But I think authentic relationships and being genuine is part of the key to success in life for me anyway, you know. For everybody. Yeah.
Oh, what were you going to say? I didn't want to interrupt that. Sorry. You were going to say I never have, you know, talking about being authentic.
Yeah, that's just been my practice, even when I was in the Marine Corps. Even when I was a cop, I mean, it was a very... People that knew me when I was a cop, I was a very unique human being. People would be like, man, you're more of a PR guy than a cop. And it is true. When I was a cop, like I just wanted to help people. Like I always looked at people that were in circumstances that maybe were, you know, on the bad side of the law, really what got them there. You know, was it drug addiction? Was it a poor upbringing? I never really looked at, they're bad people. They're scumbags or whatever. Because, you know, some people are just, dealt the cards and they don't know how to get out of the position they're in. You know, they grow up in the hood or they're raised around drug dealers. That doesn't mean they're bad people. They just don't, that's where the environment they're in. So I always tried to become a role model or build people up instead of just looking at everyone as a bad guy.
You know, that is such powerful thought and words. I really want to just pause for a minute on that because we're in the midst of a global pandemic and, you know, civil discord, the likes of which we haven't seen before or maybe since the Civil War. And, you know, I have been thinking about this lately of how important it is for all of us to try to put ourselves in other people's shoes so we can figure out how to bridge this divide.
It's interesting, especially being a former police officer. I know the word police is not popular now amongst a lot of people, and there are a lot of good cops. There's a lot of good everybody. There's good doctors, there's good priests, there's good lawyers. The problem is that I always say the 10% factor, the 10% of any occupation really damage the reputation, images, others. And it is. It's the worst time in our history. This might go down as the worst time ever in history. For disobedience and people uprising and disrespecting everything from law enforcement to the government. And I think it's all of our jobs to be kinder to people and just to see the good in people. I mean, listen, I've talked to homeless people, and one thing, even with the protein business, you know, I give samples out to homeless people, or I just run into people randomly standing on a corner that, you know, have the sign saying we'll work for food or whatever. And I chat it up sometimes with people, and I got to tell you, we're all one check. For some people, Americans, we're one check away from standing on that corner. And I never for a second take it for granted that I or someone I know could be in that position. If things are happening and the numbers you hear, they're talking about numbers of homeless are going to happen when these evictions start happening. And if you know, things don't turn around, it's scary. And there's going to be people that you and I both know that are going to be affected by that. And whether even successful millionaires, I have friends of mine that are losing their wealth over this. So everyone can be affected, and I look at everyone as the same. I'm no better than the homeless guy standing on the corner because I could be there, right?
Yeah. Well, those are powerful words, and the truth of who you are and how I see you is, you know, it would never happen to you because you have built such powerful relationships and there's so much support around you. And I think that's the key for everyone here listening, is that you give of yourself in that way. And you, I'm talking about you, Bruce, in such a way that people wouldn't let that happen. You know, those who have would make sure that you weren't on that street corner. And there's a little bit of something we can all do, is to make sure that the people around us who might be suffering are, they know they're not alone. And they know that there's people that will care for them and then take them in if that was it, where it came to, but that we're really genuinely connected.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, I mean, listen, I work hard and I have a lot of relationships. I don't think I'd ever get to that point. But I never take it for granted what I have. And
exactly.
The times are trying. And there's people I know that are very successful that are on the brink of collapse, and they don't know what to do. So it's definitely a time to support people and understand them. And even if you think maybe someone's life looks rosy and peachy, you know, I always tell people this, it's actually a practice I've done for years. I try, and I don't always do it, I try and touch at least 4 or 5 people a day. And not with any meaning, just text, hey, what's going on? Are you good? How you been? I haven't heard from you in a while. Because not everyone's good. And sometimes people wither away and never tell anyone that they were depressed or bad things are going on in their life because they're ashamed. So I always try and practice it. Sometimes it's 5 people, but I try and do it 7 days a week. You know, it could be a random text, a phone call. And I always encourage people to make phone calls. It seems like the world now, everyone wants to text. And that's okay. But nothing wrong with hearing someone's voice, you know.
Oh, I think it's way more powerful than a text. Yeah, I mean, Bruce, this is such a beautiful conversation that we're having. It's so moving to me because I get it. And, you know, one of the things that I talk about in my book is, you know, how do you overcome the weight of the phone when you are in those dark times yourself? And picking up the phone and checking in or asking about or being of service to others, to me, is the most powerful way to do that. And I don't think, you know, that there's a better way to lift yourself out of your own bad circumstances than to reach out and help others.
100%. You're spot on with that.
Yeah. Well, you're doing it every day and all the time. And I am so honored and privileged to call you my friend and to think of myself as your circle. And you know, on our last few minutes, Bruce, give us a takeaway. What would you like our listeners to know before we close for today?
Oh, gosh, what I like our listeners. life is great. And if you're, this from an entrepreneur standpoint, if you're thinking about starting a business, start it. Don't be that person that waits a year, another year, because a decade goes by and you'll see other people making that same cookie, that same widget, that same app for a computer. Just do it. Here's the worst case scenario. You borrow the money, you beg, steal, whatever it takes to get it going. You ask for people for help. You can learn everything on YouTube. But take the risks that you're – so many people live in a mundane life, I believe, and they're like, I wish I did that. Just take the risk. There's the loss is minimal. Just take the risk, and I always encourage people to follow their dreams. There's so many opportunities. If you want to write a book, write a book. I'm working on writing a book right now. I've put it off for years, and so many people kept saying, God, you have all these stories, just write a book. So I sat down with a woman finally, because I didn't think I was worthy of writing a book. I'm like, no one gives a shit about what I have to say. But at the end of the day, now I'm like, wow, I might have something to say here that people want to hear. So I always tell people, take the risk. Life is too short, and don't turn 70 to 80 years old and say, God, I didn't do anything I wanted to do. You know, so.
Beautiful.
That's
it. Yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Bruce. This has been such a powerful conversation, and I'm so grateful to you for coming on board with us and reminding us of what's important and how to get through anything with the power of your words. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.